Good morning, brothers and sisters, and welcome to God's house. A few announcements before we begin that I'd like to highlight from our bulletin is the Edgebrook Prayer Walk coming up on September 8th from 6:30 to 7:30. As I'm sure most of you have heard, there have been a number of people diagnosed with COVID at Edgebrook over the past few weeks. So I invite you to show up and pray for them as they deal, not just with the normal struggles and stress of being in a nursing home, but also with the added worry of the coronavirus. Oops. Additional announcements. Coming up this Thursday, we are having our classes meeting. So you please pray for myself and Ike as we attend online our classes meeting. And I pray that you'll pray for our classes as we discuss how we can be the church of God and do His will. Additionally, next Monday, our consistory is meeting. We also pray for all of our deacons and elders as we discuss how we here at Chandler can best serve God and be faithful to Him. So with that, brothers and sisters, may the love of the Lord Jesus Christ and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit and the love of the Father be with you all. Will you please rise in body or in spirit as we begin to worship our Lord. with you all. As Christ has welcomed you, so turn to your neighbors and welcome them. Beloved of our Lord Jesus Christ, it is our desire, with the gracious help of God, to celebrate the Lord's Supper next Sunday. It is true that when we examine ourselves, we find that there is nothing we have done to earn our place at God's royal banquet. Indeed, we have done much that should exclude us from His presence. We have not loved God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and we have not loved our neighbor as ourselves. Nevertheless, this is God's feast of love, prepared for us by the Lord Jesus Christ. For while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled to Him through the death of His Son. And how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through His life? Therefore, our self-examination must not end in despair. We are called to trust God's work on our behalf and to receive the gift of forgiveness offered us in Jesus Christ. Our reconciliation to God is found in trusting this good news, that before we loved God, God loved us. We are what God has made us, created in Christ Jesus for good works, prepared beforehand to be our way of life. The Lord's table is prepared for those who humbly trust in Christ alone and find in His life, death, and resurrection and ascension their only peace. Though we often fall short, we approach the table with the desire to please God, conforming our lives to God's purpose. Rest assured that God has forgiven you and has made you worthy children of His kingdom. Therefore, let us look at our hearts and confess our sins as we pray together. Almighty God, we have sinned against you and one another in thought, word, and deed, in what we have done, and in what we have left undone. Therefore, we pray to you. We pray together. Lord, have mercy on us. Christ, have mercy on us. Lord, have mercy on us. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us amend what we are and direct what we should be. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Brothers and sisters, our gracious God forgives you your sins, strengthens you by His Spirit, and will keep you in life eternal through Jesus Christ our Lord. So if anyone is in Christ, they are a new creation. Everything old has passed away. See, everything has been made new. All this is from God, who reconciled us to Himself through Christ and has given us the ministry of reconciliation. And all God's people say, Amen. As a hymn of thanks and praise, let us join our voices together in singing number 352, The Deep, Deep Love of Jesus, verses 1 through 3.
Yeah.
chapter 14, verses 1 through 26. Mark chapter 14, starting at verse 1. Now the Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread were only 2 days away, and the chief priests and the teachers of the law were looking for some sly way to arrest Jesus and kill him. But not during the feast, they said, for the people made riot. While he was in Bethany, reclining at the table in the home of a man known as Simon the Leper, a woman came with an alabaster jar of very expensive perfume, made of pure nard. She broke the jar and poured the perfume on his head. Some of those present were saying indignantly to one another, "Why this waste of perfume? It could have been sold for more than a year's wages, and the money given to the poor." And they rebuked her harshly. "Leave her alone," said Jesus. "Why are you bothering her? She has done a beautiful thing to me. The poor you always have with you, and you can help them anytime you want, but you will not always have me. She did what she could. She poured perfume on my body beforehand to prepare for my burial. I tell you the truth, wherever the gospel is preached throughout the world, what she has done will also be told in memory of her." Then Judas Iscariot, one of the 12, went to the chief priests to betray Jesus to them. They were delighted to hear this and promised to give him money, so he watched for an opportunity to hand him over. On the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread, when it was customary to sacrifice the Passover lamb, Jesus' disciples asked him, "Where do you want us to go and make preparations for you to eat the Passover?" So he sent two of his disciples, telling them, "Go into the city, and a man carrying a jar of water will meet you. Follow him. Say to the owner of the house he enters, 'The teacher asks, where is my guest room where I may eat the Passover with my disciples?' He will show you a large upper room, furnished and ready. Make preparations for us there." The disciples left, went into the city, and found things just as Jesus had told them. So they prepared the Passover. When evening came, Jesus arrived with the 12. While they were reclining at the table eating, he said, "I tell you the truth, one of you will betray me, one who is eating with me." They were saddened, and one by one they said to him, "Surely not I." "It is one of the 12," he replied, "one who dips bread into the bowl with me. The Son of Man will go just as it was written about him." But woe to that man who betrays the Son of Man. It would be better for him if he had not been born. While they were eating, Jesus took bread, gave thanks, and broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take it, this is my body." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and offered it to them, and they all drank from it. "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many," he said to them. "I tell you the truth, I will not drink again the fruit of the vine until the day when I drink it anew in the kingdom of God." When they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. This is the word of the Lord. I have never died. I don't really know what to expect, and nobody can consider me an expert on the subject. But in a way, everything that has happened and will happen in my life is a preparation for death. Let me use my years in school as an example. When I was in first grade, I, obviously, had not graduated from college. As a first grader, I had no idea what college was like, and I had no desire to go to college. As a first grader, I wanted to do exciting things like fly in spaceships or ride dinosaurs. College was the last thing on my mind. I grew, and eventually I went to high school, and then I started to think just a little bit about college. In my final year of high school, I did start to give it a serious thought. It would be easy then to conclude that my final year of high school was the most important year in regard to preparing for college. It was the only year where I was actively getting myself ready for what was to happen next. But that kind of thinking is wrong. I would not have gone to college if I didn't graduate from high school. And I wouldn't have graduated from high school if I didn't finish my 11th grade classes. Which wouldn't have happened if I didn't finish my 10th grade classes. And so on and so on. None of this would have happened if I didn't finish the first grade. First grade was the beginning of my academic life. And in first grade, I first began to learn the skills and develop the talents necessary to complete college. Now, even though I was thinking about college in the first grade, I was, however, being prepared for college. So in this analogy, college is the end of my academic life. And the end of my physical life on this world is death. So in a way, everything in life is preparing for me death in much the same way that first grade prepared me for college. To paraphrase Hebrews chapter 12, death is the final shaking of our lives, and our lives are shaken so that what cannot be shaken remains. Death is the final test of our lives. After death, only the eternal, divine things remain. And so death reveals what kind of lives we lived. It reveals how much of our life is built up with worldly things and how much of our lives were built up with heavenly things. But to better understand that, let us take another look at Mark chapter 14. The kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe this good news. This is the gospel that Jesus taught, and we first heard this gospel taught back in chapter 1 of Mark. Now, even though chapter 1 is the only place where we hear Jesus teach this gospel, everything that happens and everything Jesus says must be understood in relation to that gospel. The kingdom of God has come. Repent and believe the good news. Now, if teaching this gospel is all that Jesus did, then nothing in this world would have changed, and we wouldn't be here today. So let us praise God that Jesus Christ did more than talk about the gospel. He was the gospel and made it true for us today. The kingdom of God has come. It is with us today, and we can proudly say that we belong to God. Now, as Christians, we know that Jesus' sacrifice on the cross and his resurrection on the third day is what made this gospel true. What happened at the cross is not only the most important event recorded in the gospel, it is also the single most important event in our lives. But that's next week's sermon. This week's sermon is about preparation. Chapter 14 begins by telling us that the Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread were only 2 days away. Now, as anyone who has planned a wedding or a Thanksgiving feast knows, big celebrations take a lot of planning and preparation. And for the Jewish people, nothing is bigger than Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread. These days before the festival are therefore days of preparation. Most of the people in Jerusalem are preparing in the normal, traditional way. They are trying to find the right place to celebrate the feast. They are gathering the food, the bread, the wine, and of course, the Passover lamb. I'm also sure that they are singing hymns and psalms and spiritual songs. Jews and God-fearing Gentiles are gathering from around the world, representing every tribe and every tongue, and they are gathering to remember and praise God for what he has done. That is what most of the people are doing. Notable exceptions are the chief priests and the teachers of the law. They are not making preparations for the Passover. They are making preparations to kill Jesus. These religious leaders are not focused on their religious responsibility of preparing to sacrifice the many thousands of Passover lambs. Instead, they are focused on causing the death of a single man. This is ironic because that single man is Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. In a way, they are doing their job because they are preparing to sacrifice this Lamb of God so that the sins of the world may be taken away. But they are not making preparations out of love and respect for God's commands, And they are certainly not making these preparations because they believe in Jesus. Rather, they are preparing to sacrifice Jesus in order to protect their own power and wealth. Of course, these men are not the only ones making preparations for Jesus' sacrifice. While Jesus is in Bethany, an unnamed woman enters the home and anoints Jesus with an expensive bottle of perfume. I'm sure that most of you are familiar with the other gospel accounts of this story, and you know that this woman is Mary, the sister of Martha and Lazarus, and a close friend of Jesus. But we are not reading those gospels today. Today we are reading the gospel according to Mark, and today this woman is anonymous. So let me read verse 3 again, and pay close attention to who is named. While he is in Bethany, reclining at the table in the home of a man known as Simon the leper, a woman came with an alabaster jar of very expensive perfume made of pure nard. She broke the jar and poured the perfume on his head. It is the town of Bethany which is named, and we also hear the name of Simon the leper. Bethany and Simon the leper. These are not big, impressive names. They are normal, common, everyday places and people. And in the middle of this normal, common, everyday place and people is Jesus Christ, the Son of God. But we just call him He. We, of course, know that He is Jesus, but this should make the absence of His name all the more important for us. Jesus Christ, He is the Son of God. He is the Word and the Lamb. He is Lord of Lords and Prince of Peace. And here He is, simply He. He is one of us normal, common, everyday people. And while He is reclining, a woman comes with an alabaster jar of very expensive perfume, made of pure nard. She then breaks the jar and pours the perfume on his head. In Jesus' own words, this is a beautiful act. So let's dwell a moment and appreciate what has happened. Peter tells us that this story takes place in Bethany, and then he brings our attention into the house of Simon the leper and focuses us on the alabaster bottle of pure nard. We are not looking at Jesus or at Mary. We are looking at a stone bottle, the color of cream, and full of the most expensive perfume. And what happens to this bottle? It is broken. This is a stone bottle, not a vessel of clay. The bottle itself is very expensive. It is intended to last a long time and to be reused. A stone jar is not like cheap plastic or clay. And she does not take the lid off or even break the seal. No, she breaks the jar. Stone jars do not break by accident. This was done with intentional force. This bottle is being used to serve God, and it will be used for nothing else ever again. And after breaking the stone bottle, the pure nard is poured on his head. This story is often called the anointing of Jesus at Bethany, even though the text does not tell us that Jesus is anointed. Now, this is not a problem because Jesus is definitely being anointed here, but there is more going on. As we watch this scene, we see that Jesus is being completely covered with the liquid, and the use of the more common word pour allows us to remember the last time Jesus was completely covered with the liquid. This should remind us of Jesus' baptism. And don't get me wrong, Jesus is not being baptized here, but these two events are being tied together. Jesus did not baptize himself. He was baptized by John the Baptist, a man and a prophet. And at that time, John the Baptist was more well-known than Jesus, who, to all appearances, was just some guy from Galilee. Similarly, Jesus does not anoint himself. He was anointed by a woman, an unnamed woman, and here we are today talking about her. John the Baptist and this unnamed woman, both are united in Jesus. Truly, the last has become first, and the first has become last, and we are all united as one in Jesus. And after she breaks the bottle, she pours the expensive nard onto his head. I want us to note that later in this chapter, Jesus will pick up a cup of wine and say, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many." What is lost in our English translations is that the original Greek uses two very different words, which we translate as pour. The word Jesus uses has religious significance and describes how a priest pours out a drink offering to God. This is an important word and is found many times throughout the Bible. Now, on the other hand, the pour the woman performs is the more common everyday Greek word for pour. But here's the thing. That word is found only here in this story. As far as the Bible is concerned, this is a unique event. Now, I don't know if Peter or Mark intended this to happen, but I do believe the Holy Spirit is telling us and showing us that God uses the normal, everyday things to do his holy will. The last shall be first, and the stone the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. It is the common, everyday poor people who have been rejected by the rich and powerful that are used to build God's kingdom. And, as I mentioned earlier, the time that this is taking place is during a time of preparation for the Passover feast. This requires a massive amount of cleaning and food preparation, and this woman spends her time by anointing Jesus. Like the chief priests, she is not preparing for the feast in the normal way. But this is no ordinary Passover. She is preparing the Lamb of God for the final Passover sacrifice. Unlike those chief priests who are preparing to sacrifice Jesus because of their unbelief, she is preparing Jesus because she does believe in him. Unfortunately, it seems like the disciples don't get it yet. Some of the disciples were indignant and rebuked her harshly. They were too distracted by how much the perfume cost to understand what was happening. Many pastors try to calculate how much this perfume costs in today's dollars, but I think that leads us into making the same mistake the disciples made. We can become too focused on the money and fail to see the deeper sacrifice being made. This alabaster jar of pure nard represents more than a year's wages. It also represents more than her life savings. It represents her life. Now, we have good reason to believe that this jar of perfume is her dowry. Our society today does not use dowries, so it's hard to fully describe the cost. In short, a dowry is money or property a woman would use to help support herself and her children. It represents her ability to help the husband start and raise a family. Without a dowry, this woman would not be able to help start her own household. And because of that, it is unlikely that she will be married. This woman has given up her ability to control her life. Just like the widow who put in two small coins at the temple, this woman has given her everything to God, and now she is completely dependent upon God to care for her. And when we see her act in this light, we see that she has betrothed herself to God. She has prepared herself to be the bride of Christ, and we all should prepare ourselves to be the same. And that is why we remember what she has done. Brothers and sisters, do not be like Judas or the other disciples who saw how much money was being wasted. Their actions prove that they still belong to money. Be like the woman who proved by her actions that she belonged to God. But that was last week's sermon. This week, we are focusing on preparation. The Jews in today's passage are preparing to celebrate the Passover. Similarly, we are preparing to celebrate the Lord's Supper next week. Now, on the surface, Passover and communion are both religious ceremonies performed by human beings, but both go much deeper than mere human works. Passover is when God's people remember when God passed through the land of Egypt and brought his people up and out of that land of slavery. Similarly, communion is when God's people remember when God passed through death and brought his people up and out of that land of slavery. So it should be no surprise that during Jesus' last Passover, on the night before he was betrayed, that Jesus Christ, the Son of God, would make a new covenant between God and God's people. For Jews, the Passover celebration is a reminder of the covenant God made with his people while they were slaves in Egypt. God promised that he would free them and that he would be their God. Each Passover, faithful Jews remember what God has done, and they recommit their lives to being his people. God did not bring the Israelites out of Egypt so that they may be slaves again in the Promised Land. No, he brought them up so that they may be a holy nation committed to a deep, personal relationship with him. And the only human relationship which comes close to describing how deep and personal a relationship this is supposed to be is marriage. When Jesus celebrates this Passover with his disciples, he makes changes to the expected routine. Most notable is that Jesus declares the bread to be his body, and he declares the cup of wine to be the blood of his covenant. These words would be surprising to Jesus' disciples, not because they are new words, but because these words come from a betrothal ceremony. Now, like dowries, betrothal ceremonies are not something we do anymore. When a man and a woman become betrothed in that society, they become legally and spiritually married to each other, but they are not yet physically married. For the new husband and bride, the time of being betrothed is a time of preparation. It is a time when they prepare themselves mentally and emotionally to be completely united in marriage. So when we step back and see the entirety of this story, we see the unnamed woman presents her dowry to Jesus, and he accepts it. I find that it's important that this woman is unnamed because it allows us to step into her shoes and offer our own lives as a dowry to Jesus. And even though we have done nothing to deserve his acceptance, we have full confidence in knowing that he will accept our lives. Indeed, he has already accepted our lives as his own. Jesus has already offered the bread of his body and the blood of his covenant to us. All that remains is for us to accept what Jesus offers and accept him as our own. And now I would like us to take a closer look at what Jesus and the disciples do for this final Passover feast. In verse 23 we read, "Then he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank from it." I hope this reminds you of what happened in chapter 10, when James and John asked Jesus to sit at his right and at his left hand. Jesus asks, "Can you drink the cup I drink, or be baptized with the baptism I am baptized with?" They answered, "Yes," though at the time they didn't understand what they were agreeing to. And now Jesus' words are fulfilled. "You will drink the cup I drink and be baptized with the baptism I am baptized with." But it's not just James and John who drink of this same cup. It is all the disciples who drink the same cup that Jesus drank. And not just the 12 disciples, but all of Jesus' disciples. All of us drink from the same cup. By the blood of Jesus Christ, you, me, and all of God's people are made one in the church, which is the body of Christ. This is a mystery, for just as there is one God made up of three persons in the Trinity, so also the church is made up of many persons, but we are one church. After we have drunk from the same cup as Jesus, what are we supposed to do? To answer that question, let us take a look at verse 22. "While they were eating, Jesus took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, 'Take it, this is my body.'" We have already seen Jesus do this two times already. Twice before, we saw Jesus take bread, give thanks, break the bread, and then give it to his disciples. We saw Jesus do this when he fed the 4,000 and the 5,000. In fact, the words which describe Jesus' action in all three stories are almost identical. In the two feeding stories, the disciples share the bread Jesus gave them with all the people, and everyone was satisfied. Now, again, Jesus has given bread to his disciples, but will they share that bread with all the people? Well, we wouldn't be here today in church if they had not, but that means the question is now being asked of us. Brothers and sisters, you have drunk from the cup of Jesus Christ, and you have received the bread from Jesus. Will you now share that bread with the people? Now, before we finish this sermon, I want to remind you all that in the coming week, we are preparing ourselves to celebrate communion next Sunday. Much has been said in the past about appropriate and inappropriate participation in the Lord's Supper. In Mark 14, we see that it is the chief priests and Judas who have an inappropriate participation in the Passover and the Lord's Supper. Their participation was inappropriate because they did not believe Jesus. And they did not believe Jesus because they did not love Jesus. And because they did not love Jesus, they did not show grace to the people. Brothers and sisters, prepare yourselves mentally and emotionally to celebrate the Lord's Supper next week as if you were preparing yourselves for marriage. Push aside all the other suitors vying for your love. Do this by loving Jesus with all of your heart, with all of your soul, with all of your mind, and with all of your strength. And love your neighbor as yourself. And in all things, to God be the glory. As a hymn of response, let us sing number 542, My Life is in You, Lord. Let us pray to God and give thanks for their generous gifts. Holy Father, Holy Son, and Holy Ghost, I thank you for gathering us together as one in your church. I thank you, Lord, for the many gifts and blessings you have rained upon us. And Lord, I pray that you accept our first fruits as a holy sacrifice. May this build your church. May our offerings, Lord, be used to bring grace and healing to this world. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Violence and chaos, that your spirit will calm the storm of human sin. Pray that you'll open up a way in our lives and in our country so that we can be a loving and gracious people. Pray that you'll fill us with your light, that we'll be able to share the bread that you've given us with the world around. And Lord, I thank you that our children and our schools have completed the first week of school. Pray, Lord, that you'll continue to give them strength and encouragement as they learn new things, as they do their homework. I thank you for the teachers and staff, Lord, that look over our children and grandchildren, and I pray that you'll give them encouragement to continue to share their lives with those children. Bless their work so that our kids may grow straight and true and do good work in the future. Lord, I thank you for our grandparents and parents who have gone before us, who shared their lives with us and raised us to be a holy people devoted to you. For those who are at Edgebrook and in nursing homes, Lord, I pray that your spirit will be with them. For we love them and we remember them, even though they're not here with us today. We are with them in spirit. And I pray specifically, Lord, for Edgebrook and all the people there as they are dealing with an outbreak of the coronavirus. I pray, Lord, that our prayers will be heard and that your healing hand will move with power in Edgebrook. Protect those who are still healthy and heal those who are sick so that we may continue to praise your name with all of our life. Lord, I pray for our people here in Chandler. I lift up Jolene and Hetty and Gerald and Agnes and all our other brothers and sisters, Lord, who are dealing with medical issues in times of uncertainty. Lord, we love them, and I pray that you will heal them. And I pray also, Lord, that you will open our eyes and our hands so that we can be there to provide comfort and love and encouragement when they need it most. Lord, I pray for us as a church here in Chandler. I pray that you will bless our elders and deacons as we work faithfully to lead your people here in Chandler. And I pray also for our classes as we prepare to gather later this week. May your spirit, Lord, give us wisdom to do your will. And I pray for our church, our denomination, and the church around the world. Lord, I pray that you'll bless your missionaries that you have scattered out to the four corners of our world. I pray that you'll fill them with love and light and encouragement. Protect them in the battles that they fight against the darkness. Use them to claim more people for your kingdom. And Lord, may we all share in that battle so that the darkness will be swept away and only your light may remain. In the name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. Will you please rise in body or in spirit as we sing our doxology? Number 465, Baptized in Water. Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn to you and give you peace.